Hi, in this video we are going to study occlusion in FPD. So what is occlusion? Occlusion is a static relationship between incising or masticating surfaces of maxillary and mandibular teeth or tooth analogs. Tooth analogs meaning artificial teeth. So what is occlusion in layman terms? It is how the upper and the lower teeth are going to match each other or intercuspate with each other. So before you start rehabilitation of a new missing teeth or you start with a new case, you have to understand what is actually present in the patient's mouth. So occlusion is not only important in restoring form and function, but you have to understand occlusion right from the diagnostic step. So there are two types of occlusion that you see in a dentate patient. That is group function or unilateral balanced occlusion and canine protected or mutually protected or organic occlusion. So the names are very self-explanatory. Let us go through each of them one by one. In group function occlusion, it is a group which is going to function together, okay? Or unilateral balanced occlusion. Balanced means there is going to be simultaneous tooth contact on one side because it is unilateral. So if you see first image, you have the canine, the premolars and the molar touching, this molar. They are touching the antagonist tooth even in lateral movements. So that is called group function because a group of teeth are functioning here in occlusion. But this is only on one side. If you take your jaw on the right side, you can do it with me during the video. So if you take your jaw on the right side, you will feel that there are some teeth or maybe one tooth touching on that side. The other teeth are naturally, normally not touching. If they are touching, it is pathologic. So on this side, there is touching of the teeth and the other side, there is no touching of the teeth. That is why it is called unilateral balanced occlusion or group function occlusion. In technical words, it is called It is characterized by working side contacts from canine to third molar and no balancing side contact. Now, what is working side and what is balancing side? So, if you take your jaw on the right side, your right side is the working side. On the working side, there is contact. On the other side, which is the balancing side, there is no contact. So, this is group function occlusion, also known as unilateral balanced occlusion. Okay. And then next, we have the canine protected or mutually protected or organic occlusion. Now, if you see this image here, here only the canines are touching in lateral movement. Lateral movements are also called excursion. Anything apart from your maximum intercuspation. Maximum intercuspation means when you are closing a cusp to fossa relation in the most closed position, that is your maximum intercuspation. If you move from that, it is called excursion. So, canine protected occlusion, only the canines will touch. When you take your jaw right to left, it is possible. See, you can have canine guided occlusion, you can have mutually protected occlusion, both of them are normal. You can have canine guided on one side, mutually protected on, you can have group function on the other side. So it is very normal to have a variable occlusal scheme. So canine protected is also called mutually protected. Now what is mutually protected occlusion? So now when you are biting completely, you can do it with me during the video. You keep your teeth in contact with each other. Okay. So now we have our teeth in contact. So at this point of time, normally our anterior teeth will not touch each other. Only our posterior teeth are going to touch each other. So when you are in maximum intercuspation, your posterior teeth are protecting your anterior teeth. They are not letting a lot of load come on your anterior teeth. Correct. Now try to glide your mandible forwards and come edge to edge. That is called protrusion. When you protrude like this, your posterior teeth are not touching, but only your anterior teeth, especially till your canines are touching. So your anteriors are helping to protect your posteriors in protrusion. So they are mutually protecting each other. That is why it is called mutually protected occlusion or organic occlusion, because it is a normal, naturally occurring kind of an occlusal scheme. So it is called organic occlusion, which is characterized only canine contact on working side and disocclusion of posterior teeth on the balancing side. So I hope these terminologies are clear, group function and canine guided occlusion. So let's have a few scenarios and what is functionally better for what kind of a situation, what is indicated for what based on this table. These are our meritus prep facts. So in FPD, it is better for posterior pontic to avoid contact in. So whenever you have an FPD, you don't want the posterior pontic to have contacts on the balancing side. Like I told you, on the balancing side, there should be no contact, right? On the working side, there will be contact. On the balancing side, absolutely no contact because it is not present in our natural dentition. Yeah, but one thing that you have to remember that complete denture occlusion is different from a partial denture occlusion, especially the fixed occlusion scheme. So do not get confused between the two of them. Okay. The most reproducible relation of jaw that is used in FPD construction. Now, wherever you see the word most reproducible relation, it has to be centric relation. Centric relation is independent of tooth contact. It is your condyle to fossa relation. So it is the most reproducible. If you have to guide the patient into one stable position, that is your centric relation. You can do plus and minus along this relation. Other than this relation, you will not have any very reproducible relation. Then next, deflective contacts are corrected first in. Deflective means these are interferences. Whenever you give a restoration, the first corrections that are supposed to be made are in centric relation. Okay, so in centric relation, the first deflective contacts are to be corrected. Then the next one, a cusp should be reduced if it is deflective in, if it is causing interference in which movement, then when will you reduce a cusp? So these positions are centric as well as eccentric positions. So in protrusion, lateral, centric, in all kind of movements, you will see if the cusp is interfering, it should be reduced. Okay, then the next is Bull's technique. BULL technique is used to reduce the cusp when interference is in. BULL meaning buccal of upper and lingual of lower. These are non-functional cusps. So when will you reduce these cusps? When you have working side contacts or laterotrusive contacts. So if you have contacts on the working side, whichever side you are taking your jaw, if you see interferences on those side, then you are going to reduce your non-functional cusp, that is buccal of upper and lingual of lower. Okay, so now let's have a look at the factors which are going to determine the occlusal morphology. Now, why is this important? You are going to rehabilitate a patient with new teeth. So it is important to understand what kind of occlusal scheme you are going to give, what kind of occlusal anatomy you are going to give. So the cusp fossa relationship is what occlusion is all about. And how do you determine that? So there are a few factors which are going to determine. So first we will start with the vertical determinants and then we will come to horizontal determinants. Now in the vertical determinants, you have firstly the condylar guidance. This is similar to that you see in balanced occlusion in Hanau's squint in complete denture occlusion. So condylar guidance is the angle formed by the condyle in the fossa. It is a patient dependent factor and you cannot change it. So the normal condylar guidance is around 33 degrees. If the condylar guidance is very steep, if you see the steepness of the condylar guidance is too much, if this angle increases, then you have to give taller cusp in the posterior. Okay. So if your condylar guidance is more, you will give taller cusp in the posterior. Now, how do you remember this? It is difficult to remember these kind of technicality. So there is something called as Thielmann's formula, which is also applicable in complete denture case. So in Thielmann's formula, it is going to give you the proportionality between the different elements, vertical components. So you have your condylar guidance and incisal guidance upon plane of occlusion, compensating curves and cuspal height is going to give you balanced occlusion. Here we are not achieving balanced occlusion, but we are going to try to correlate with them. So if your condylar guidance is increasing, the cuspal height is directly proportional to the condylar inclination or the condylar guidance. So if CI increases, condylar inclination increases, then your cuspal height should also increase to make it proportional. Okay. Then next is your incisal guidance or your anterior guidance, which is determined by the lingual slopes of your upper anterior teeth. So if you have a lot of overbite, you will need more separation. Here we are not talking about posterior tooth contact. Here we are talking about anterior separation. So greater the vertical overlap, greater the horizontal overlap. If the incisal guidance is too steep, if it is too steep, again, you will need taller posterior cusp. Okay. If greater the vertical overlap, you will need taller posterior cusp. Greater the horizontal overlap, you will need shorter posterior cusp. Okay, so this is the correlation between your incisal guidance and the cusp height. Then you have your plane of occlusion. Steepness of the plane of occlusion is governed by the compensating curves, like curve of Spee. So more parallel to the condylar guidance, if it is more parallel to the condylar guidance, if this angle and the plane of occlusion are in similar planes, then you will give shorter posterior cusp. So your cuspal anatomy is going to be determined by factors which are vertical determinants and horizontal determinants. we are still to look at the other vertical determinants. So here other vertical determinants, like I told you, is the compensating curves like curve of P. More acute the curve, this is your curve of P. Okay, so more acute the curve, shorter is the preferred height of the posterior cusp tips. And then you have your lateral movement or the Bennett movement. So you have a rotation, rotating side and the orbiting side. So your condyles are going to move laterally. That is a lateral translation movement that is occurring. This is called Bennett movement. So greater the movement on the working side, you are going to give shorter cusp tip. More superior the movement, again shorter posterior cusp tips. And greater the side shift, shorter cusp tips. So if Bennett movement is more, your cusp tips would be more. If your curve of P is more acute, acute means smaller. So your cusp tips will also be smaller. Here we are not aiming at posterior tooth contact in excursion. So it is not exactly like balanced occlusion. Do not get confused. Here we are wanting posterior tooth occlusion. In excursion, we want those contacts to be there. Like how it is there in your mouth. At the beginning of the video, we demonstrated, we saw that on the working side, there has to be contact. On the balancing side, there has to be no contact. So to achieve that, you are going to determine the cuspal height. So whether you have to keep it long or short is determined according to a lot of factors. Then coming to the horizontal determinants now. We saw the vertical determinants. Now we have the horizontal determinants. It includes relationship that influence the direction of ridges and grooves on the occlusal surface. So earlier we saw the cuspal anatomy. Now we are going to see the direction of the ridges and the grooves. So if the distance from the rotating condyle is high, then you will give wider angle between the laterotrusive and the mediotrusive pathways. So you have to remember that if you have more distance from the intercondylar region, then you will give wider distance between the lateral and the medial sides for the pathways to balance out. Then if the distance from the mid sagittal plane is greater, then again you will give a wider angle between the lateral and the mediotrusive pathways. So greater the angle and greater the plane, greater the distance, you are going to give a wider angle for the medial and the lateral pathways. Similarly, if the lateral translation movement is great, then you will give wide angles, lateral and protrusive both. And if the intercondylar distance is great, then you will smaller the angle between lateral and protrusive pathways. So only if the intercondylar distance is great, then you will give a smaller angle. Otherwise, you will give a wider angle for the other parameters that we just saw. So smaller will be the angle between the laterotrusive and the mediotrusive pathways for a greater intercondylar distance. This is a commonly asked question in entrance exams. So this one you have to specifically remember that if the intercondylar distance is great, then smaller will be the angle between laterotrusive and mediotrusive pathways. So based on the vertical and the horizontal determinants, you have decided the occlusal morphology for a given patient. Now you have taken a Bake trial for that case, you have taken a coping trial for that case, and you have to do occlusal correction in FPD. Now specifically talking of multiple units, here we can also think of a full mouth case where we are doing the occlusal correction. So it is the initial and the final procedure. Why? Because you start looking at the natural interferences. The interferences present in the natural dentition, if they require any modification, then you are going to modify them first and then address the prosthesis. And occlusal discrepancies in natural dentition opposing a complete denture are eliminated at immediate possible appointment after the diagnosis. So if you have a combination of fixed and a removable kind of a denture, then you are going to immediately eliminate the risk of all the interferences in the first diagnostic appointment itself. So how do you go about correcting these deflective contacts? Deflective contacts is nothing but interferences. And here we are going to understand how do you occlusally correct it. So obviously we are going to use an articulating paper to see whether the interferences are actually there or not. So when incisal edge of the lower anterior touch the maxillary lingual fossa in centric relation. Now in centric relation, if you are normally having a proper dentition, your incisal edges of the lower will not touch the upper lingual fossa. That is an interference. It will not allow protrusion to happen properly. In that case, you will reduce the lower incisal edges. So that is one way of reducing. Next is incisal edge of the lower anterior touching the maxillary lingual fossa, both in centric and eccentric relation. So here it was only centric, here it is also in lateral movements. So you are going to deepen the lingual fossa of the upper teeth and reduce the incisal edge of the lower teeth. You are going to do a combination of both. Only for centric relation, just reduce the incisal edges. If it is centric and eccentric relation, you are going to deepen the lingual fossa of the maxillary and you are going to reduce the incisal edges of the lower teeth. Now coming to posterior teeth, the deflective contact or interference is only in centric relation. Only in centric, if there is a problem, then you are going to reduce the fossa or the marginal ridge and not the cusp. If the deflective contact is in centric and eccentric, then you are going to reduce both the fossa and the cusp. Okay, it is very easy. If only centric, then only incisal edges. If centric, eccentric, then fossa plus edges. If only posterior teeth centric, then here also fossa. If centric and eccentric, then fossa plus cusp. So for two problems, you are going to reduce two things. That is how you can easily remember this. So this is anterior teeth and posterior teeth interferences. So after correcting these occlusal interferences, we have to be sure that we've done it correct. There are a few commonly made mistakes or errors that can occur in grinding of anatomic teeth. So what are these errors? In centric occlusion, if the teeth are too long, then your fossa can be deepened. You are not going to grind off the cusp. If your teeth come in end-to-end situation, then you are going to grind the cuspal inclines, the lingual of the maxilla and buccal inclines of the mandibular teeth. You are not going to reduce the cusp, that is going to reduce the vertical height. What you are going to do is you are just going to want to slide the molars into each other. So you will reduce only the inclines, the cuspal inclines, not the cuspal height. Remember, that is because you don't want the vertical dimension to reduce. So that is teeth in end-to-end situation. If there is too much of horizontal overlap, then you are going to reduce the maxillary, lingual and mandibular buccal cusps and make them narrow, not short. If there is too much of horizontal overlap, you are just going to narrow down the cusp tips and you are not going to shorten them. So these are the different errors and how do you manage them. So there are six types of errors. Coming to a fresh new concept in the occlusal correction, there are these six type of errors which occur in the working side during eccentric movement. So if you take your jaw on the right side, your right side is the working side and that is an eccentric movement because it is not in normal centric position. So what are these errors which require shortening of the cusp? Before this we saw which are the possible problems that can occur and we saw that we are not going to shorten the cusp tip. We are either going to reduce and deepen the fossa or we are going to make the cusp tip narrower. So when are you going to shorten the cusp tip? So these are the six problems that can occur, six errors that can occur in which you are going to reduce the cusp tip. So the first one is maxillary buccal and mandibular lingual cusps are too long. If the cusps are too long, then you are going to shorten them. So maxillary buccal and mandibular lingual cusps are shortened. Correct? The next one is only buccal cusp is contacting. So if there is only buccal cusp contact, that means it is a longer cusp. So you will shorten the buccal cusp from the central fossa to the cusp tip throughout. Okay, you cannot selectively just round off and make it flat. So you are going to shorten the buccal cusp from the central fossa to the cusp tip. Only lingual cusps are contacting. So buccal incline of the mandibular lingual cusp should be corrected in order to shorten the cusp. You are going to reduce the buccal incline of the mandibular lingual cusp. Mandibular lingual cusp will be the mesial and the distal, mesolingual and the distolingual. So only the buccal incline of that you are going to reduce in order to shorten the cusp. Then the fourth error. The fourth error is maxillary cusps are mesial to the intercuspating position. They are mesial to the position required. So grinding should be done on the mesial incline of the maxillary buccal, mesial incline of the maxillary buccal and the distal incline of the mandibular buccal cusp. So if there is a problem on the mesial side, you are going to do the mesial incline of the maxillary buccal and distal incline of the mandibular buccal cusp tips. That is how you are going to shorten the cusp. If the maxillary cusps are distal to the intercuspal position, then you are going to do distal inclines of the maxillary buccal and mesial incline of the mandibular buccal. They are vice versa of each other. So if you have mesial, then mesial of the upper and distal of the lower. And if you have a distal problem, then you are going to do distal of the upper and mesial of the lower. If there is no contact due to excessive contact on the balancing side, that means you are taking it to the right and on the left side there is too much of contact. So in that kind of a scenario, you are going to reduce the buccal cusp of the mandibular teeth on the balancing side so that you can reduce that much force. You do not want contact on the balancing side, so you will reduce the functional cusp on the balancing side, which is the buccal cusp of the mandibular teeth. So now we've already realized that it is a complicated topic to understand. Occlusion is not an easy topic. It requires a thorough understanding of the subject. I'm sure this video was useful to you for understanding this. So there are a few questions that you need to focus on from exam point of view. One is the centric relation and its importance that we discussed in the beginning, as to how much is the cusp and fossa relation and what kind of occlusal scheme you are looking at. So you can have questions from those. Then factors affecting occlusal morphology and their effects. The five factors, the horizontal determinants, the vertical determinants. If the condylar guidance is increasing, then what should be the effect on the cusp tip? So you should have taller cusp tip. Just an example. So you can have those kind of questions also from the factors affecting occlusal morphology and occlusal correction protocol. So what should be the occlusal correction? What are the errors in occlusal correction? When should you grind the cusp? When should you deepen the fossa? When is the mesial part reduced? When is the distal part reduced? So all these things have to be analyzed and understood based on the case that is given to you or based on the clinical scenario that is given to you. So if you understand this clearly, it is very easy. It is a basic fundamental thing that you have to apply in your clinical knowledge. So I hope this video helped you a lot. Thank you for watching this video.